Hi guys, this is Structures Explained, and in this video we'll be talking about structural components of a reinforced concrete building. A reinforced concrete building is made up of elements which transfer the loads applied on it to the ground and maintain the structural integrity of the building. For this video, we are looking at a four-storied building having a podium and a basement. A structure can be majorly divided into two components, which is substructure and superstructure. The structure which is below ground is generally called as substructure, and structure above ground is superstructure. Starting from the substructure, first we have is plain cement concrete, also termed as PCC. It is a low strength mixture of cement, fine aggregates, usually sand, and coarse aggregates. The main purpose of PCC is to provide firm, rigid, non-porous, impervious, and leveled base for RC footings, ground beams, and slab on grade. After PCC, foundation is laid which takes load from the above and transfers it to the ground below. Various kinds of footing are used in accordance with loading, site conditions, soil properties and design. In this 3D model, first we have isolated footings, then comes combined footings which holds two or more than two columns, then comes raft or mat footings, and finally strip footings which in this case is provided to basement walls. Isolated or combined footings can be connected by tie beams if required by design. These tie beams run from column to column having reinforcement similar to floor beams. Structures also use pile foundations with different number and arrangement of piles having a pile cap over it. Raft foundation can also be combined by piles below it or thickening below the column if required by design. Next we will see the retaining wall or basement wall. They are provided to retain soil from one side, and they may or may not have columns resting above it or embedded in it. Retaining wall or basement wall may have strip footing which may or may not be eccentric as per the property limits. Such walls are also used for water tanks below the ground. Next we are looking at columns below the ground, also called as column neck, as their length is shorter. These columns are embedded in soil and require appropriate waterproofing over them. After that, we take a look at ground beams which run from column to column and may have secondary beams also. These beams are protected by PCC and waterproofing. After ground beams comes slab on grade or SOG. As the name suggests, SOG is laid on the grade or ground after PCC or waterproofing. In this case, SOG acts as a basement slab. Generally, slab on grade is not connected to column beam framing and directly rests on well compacted ground below it. Next we are looking at podium with little decal of our channel. Podium is generally required for landscaping, internal vehicular movements like cars and bikes and even fire trucks in case of a fire. It may house ducts for ventilation to basement. Next we talk about is pits, manholes and trenches for drainage purposes. This component may be casted in concrete brickwork or may come as precast unit as per requirement. These elements also require PCC at bottom and proper waterproofing. Then comes concrete plinths or concrete pads. These elements support heavy machinery or equipment such as generators, water pumps, transformers and provide a firm base to them. Concrete pad can also be reinforced or unreinforced as per design requirement and can be casted on site or come in precast unit with the equipment. This ends our substructure, and now we'll see superstructure members. First we see is columns, which are vertical load bearing members on which beams and slabs rest. Columns transfer the gravity loads and lateral loads from wind and earthquake. Columns can exist in various shapes and sizes according to architectural and design requirements. They can be T-shaped, L-shaped, circular, rectangular or square-shaped. Next we discuss about various types of walls present in superstructure. First comes shear wall. These walls are part of lateral load resisting systems which counter the wind force and earthquake forces. Shear walls are placed at appropriate locations of the building by design, and they start right from the foundation of the building. A combination of shear walls connected rigidly with each other is called a core wall. The core wall generally encloses elevators, stairs or utility services in them. Core walls are also part of lateral load resisting systems of a building. Lastly, under the walls category comes upstand wall, which are reinforced concrete wall usually of lesser height and thickness and having one end free. These walls are generally present as parapet walls around openings and on the ground where some amount of retention is required. Next in superstructures comes floor beams. Floor beams take the load from the slab and transfer it to the columns, shear walls, and core walls. Beams are basically of two types. First is primary beams, which are directly connected to the columns or shear walls, and second type is secondary beams, which are connected to the primary beams and transfer load from slab to the primary beams. The beams which have one end free are called as cantilever beams. The beams which run on the perimeter of the building are called as spandrel beams. Next comes slabs. Slabs are horizontal surface which take the load on them and transfer it to the beams and columns. Slabs in superstructure are also called as suspended slabs, as they are suspended in air and not rested on the ground, as in the case of slab on grade, which we discussed earlier. There are various types of slabs based on structural and load transfer mechanisms. Based on design, the slab can be broadly categorized into two types. First is framed system and second is flat slab system. In frame type arrangement, the slab rests on beams. These beams may be further divided into primary, secondary, and tertiary beams. In the building, we also have a ramp which connects the basement to the podium and take the vehicular traffic. Ramp is also part of slab system and supported by beams and columns. Second category is flat slab system, in which slab directly transfers load to the column having drops or without it. The drops above the column prevent the punching of the column into the slab and provide stiffness over that area. If the thickness of slab alone is enough to resist the shear, the drops can be removed. Flat slabs can also be accompanied by beams at required locations, such as perimeter of the building and around the openings. Last but not the least comes stairs, which can be casted at site or come in precast panels. They can be of various types, such as L-shaped, U-shaped, spiraled, curved, as per requirements. The stairs can be enclosed in a core wall like in this case or rest at columns and beams as per design. I would also like to mention openings as a part of structural components, as opening break the load path and extra care has to be taken while providing size of the openings and reinforcement around them. Openings are mainly governed by architectural or MEP requirements. That's it for this video, guys. We have more videos lined up covering each topic in detail, so do subscribe the channel and hit the bell icon to get notified for new uploads. See you in the next one.